try to repeat again. Oh, wait a minute. Okay. Let's try to repeat again what Marco says in Bulgarian so that everyone can understand this. Greetings from Belgrade right now, and welcome back to our new session of online seminars. Today we have the honor to have with us Giuliano Giuffrida and to listen to his talk. It is entitled Long-Term Data Preservation and Digital Codicology on the Vatican Apostolic Library. Mr. Giuffrida, just to briefly present him, is currently working for the coordination of IT services of the Vatican Apostolic Library, and he's involved in the management of the internal manuscripts database and in the digitization project of the library. So he will tell us about this, like, you know, shortly. So thank you for being here with us, Mr. Giuffrida, and I will leave you the virtual floor for this seminar today. Thank you so much.
Okay. Thank you to you for the invitation. It's a pleasure to be here. And allow me to introduce myself just a bit. I'm an astronomer. I'm not a codicologist or expert of manuscript, but I really love the study of manuscript. Actually, I have a large expertise on image analysis, big data management, databases, and artificial intelligence. So I'm applying all this knowledge to the manuscript of the Vatican Library, and I will talk to you about this. This is the outline of Dolco. First of all, a really quick introduction on the Vatican Library digitization project. Actually, I will need about 1 hour just to illustrate briefly all the projects, so I will go really, really quick in here. But please stop me if you have any question. Then I will talk about our long-term data preservation archive that is based on the use of the FITS image file format. I will tell to you what is the FITS file format, why we pick this apparently strange format for our archive. And then I will talk about the study of digital codicology that you are performing on these images on the Vatican Library. That's the outline. So, Vatican Library, what is the Vatican Library? The Vatican Library is located inside the Vatican City. Is this here inside the circle? It's directly connected, as you can see, with the Apostolic Palace and with the Vatican Museum. And it's quite an old and quite beautiful institution. I encourage you to come to the Vatican Library to study your manuscript. It's an incredibly beautiful place, just to picture show to you what is how beautiful is the Vatican Library. And you probably already know the history of our library, but anyway, short summary, founded by Nicholas V, almost 600 years ago. But actually the Vatican Library is the direct heir of most ancient libraries. So the history starts quite before, to be honest. And the most important thing to remember is that the Vatican Library is not a theological or religious library. It's a library that contains all kinds of books for all kinds of studies. The Vatican Library today preserves over 80,000 manuscripts, more than one and a half million books, printed books. A lot of them are in Cunabula, some of them are in Cunabula, 8,000. We have also coins, medals, print photographs, quite a lot of treasures. And we plan to digitize at least the most important pieces of each collection. Obviously, the most important object to digitalize are our manuscripts. So the digitization project started in 2012. So far, we digitized 7 million pages, more or less, that are distributed among 24,000 shelf marks volumes. The amount of data is about alpha petabyte, just the long-term reservation images, alpha petabyte. At the end, only the images will weight about 1.6 petabyte. At the end here is, for me, the whole manuscript, all the manuscript collection, the manuscript books, so 80,000 volumes. But actually, we have many other things digitized after that. And this number will grow anyway, because we don't want to preserve just the image, but also the raw images, that is the signal acquired by the camera and scanner. We also have, in some cases, multi-frequency analysis on a single page. So for one page, we don't have just one image, but in some cases, 16 images, for example. So this number will certainly grow. The whole workflow of the Vatican Library is quite complex. I will not explain everything because as I said, it will need a dedicated talk, perhaps. But I will concentrate here on our long-term data preservation. After the acquisition, the images are acquired in TIFFL formats. They are checked and validated, and we'll see this, and then converted in FITS format for the long-term data preservation. And this is exactly what I will tell you now. So now we will concentrate on the FITS file format and our long-term data preservation archive. Again, if I go too fast, please stop me. Don't worry. What is FITS? FITS is a format that has been created in the late 70s and formalized at the beginning of the 80s. It has been designed by USA and European astronomers. It was meant at the beginning just for astronomers. It was a format to exchange data, so the T for transport in the acronym. But it's a beautiful format for data preservation because it has been created and maintained with the motto in mind, once fits, always fits. That means that the backward compatibility is ensured, always ensured. In other words, we can pick a FITS file created 40 years ago, and we can open it with a bonded PC and a model software without any problem. That's one of the main strong points of the format. But there are many other advantages. It's a format completely open, well documented, and free to use. It has a maximum color depth of 64 bits for each color channel, no limit on file size. You can put more than one image in one file. No limit on image resolution, and so on. It is so suitable for long-term data preservation that in Italy we created a new standard just to illustrate how to preserve long-term images, digital images, using FITS file format. This is an Italian standard and will be soon be translated in English if you are curious, but I will now, after I will summarize the standard in a few slides. As I said, the data has been validated during the digitization project. Each TIFF file produced is validated using a well-known software called JOB. It's an open source software you can download. It has been created to check that the file are well-formed, basically. And for that concern, FITS file, we wrote our own original software for data validation that check not only the conformity of the file to the standard, but also the conformity of the file to our digitization project. We have several requirements. Just a quick slide to show to you how work the validation software. Basically, there is a connection between another software that manages all the acquisition, and each file is checked constantly, but I don't want to talk about this topic is too much. Another topic is that the FITS format is quite useful also to contain raw images, that is the images that are directly acquired from the camera and the scanner. And we wrote a software that converts everything in FITS, taking advantage of the Adobe DNG format as an intermediate step. If you are curious, this software that has been created by myself and Kit Knox, an ML researcher, it's written in pure Java code, no dependencies, no external driver. It's available in GitHub if you want to see how it works. And we are quite happy with the software because it read and write DNG. DNG is actually a TIFF file modified to embed raw data. DNG fits a file byte by byte without using any software driver. So it's also quite useful to understand how this file is formed. Okay, now let's move to one fundamental question. Why FITS? Why you're using the FITS file? I already said many advantages of the format, and now I will describe to you what, in my opinion, is the main strong point of the format. Let's make this little game together you have a bunch of fixed files. You don't know anything on how these files are written, how to read this file. You don't have any software available. You want to read the file. I will show to you quickly that JavaScript is these three assumptions, and of course, a bit of knowledge of informatics. You can open the file. You should understand the concept of bit and byte. You should understand the concept of file. And you should know, at least in part, of the ASCII encoding. The ASCII encoding is probably the most ancient codification informatics. It converts a byte, that is a sequence of 8 bit. A bit is simple, a value that can have 0 or 1 as value. 8 bit form a byte. Each byte can be converted in a character. This is the ASCII encoding. It's the most ancient and most well-known encoding in informatics. Look at what happens if you open a FITS file with an hexadecimal editor that can understand the ASCII codification. You can actually read something. That's important. You can quickly understand that you should format this with 8-column length, the text, because it became like this. But it's quite simple to see. And you can see that at the beginning of the file, you have an ASCII text, quite readable, and it looks like a dictionary. You have a key, simple, bitpix and axis, and the values, T8, 2, and so on. So there is a dictionary that describes something. You could probably could not understand everything, but you understand the ASCII, and you understand that from a certain point, the ASCII codification fail because you obtain something that is unreadable. So what is this something else? Well, if you try to format your hexadecimal code using the number you can read here, for example, 200, you obtain something like this. This is a pure hexadecimal code. This is not ASCII art. It's just the hexadecimal code really de-zoomed to appreciate it. And if you have an high contrasted image, like in this case, you can recognize immediately this is an image, actually. And this is the image, this image, the logo of the Vatican Library. If you have, again, an highly contrasted FITS file, color FITS file, you will see something like this. Basically, the same image repeated 3 times, that are three colors, red, green, blue. So you will understand now why I show you this little game. It's because with really few assumptions, you can quickly understand that this file contains an image and you can open it, understanding how to convert from byte to intensity. Colors. And let's go now into a bit of formalities. The Library of Congress, but also the European Congress, define a set of requirements that a data format should satisfy to be suitable for long-term data preservation. 7 requirements. They are listed here. I'll go quick on these 5 requirements because they are quite simple, but quite important. The first one is disclosure. You want to use a format that is well documented. And this is certainly the case of the FITS file format. You want to use a format that is well adopted, not something new created only for your project. And the FITS file, it's widely adopted, especially in astronomy, but also in other fields. There are archives with millions or even billions of FITS file. For example, the European Southern Observatory or the HST archives and so on. You want something that has no external dependencies. You don't want to use a format that needs a special piece of software or hardware to be read. And this is the case of FITS file again. You want something that has no impact with patents. Of course, you don't want patents involved in long-term data preservation. And certainly you don't want technical protection mechanism in long-term data preservation. You want something immediately readable. I will spend a few words on transparency in safe documentation. I will show to you how transparent is a FITS file and how self-documented. Let's see a bit in details how a FITS file is formed. We already saw that, but now a bit more formal. A basic FITS file is composed of 2 portions, header and data. The header part is in ASCII format, as we saw in the sample before. Each header is composed by block of 280,080 bytes. Each block is composed by 36 couple of key values, the dictionary we saw before, that's the header. After the header, you have the data that is typically the images, now it actually the FITS file could also contain tables and other things, but I will not go into details now. The images is, sorry? Okay, I move on. The data format that is separated in block of 280 bytes and contains the image. One interesting thing is that you can replicate this structure actually, and you can put more couple of header data inside a single FITS file. That means that if you put more than one image on a FITS file, actually you can put an entire book in one FITS file, or even an entire shelf or cabinet inside the one FITS file, if you want to do so. And what means transparency for a FITS file? Means that just reading the first 480 bytes, that are the first seven keys that you can see here of a file, you have a sort of file access guide of the file. Reading these numbers, 8 means that the image contains an 8-bit images, meaning that one byte corresponds to one pixel. That's basically what this means. You know that this is a three-dimensional image because we have X, Y, this is the size of the image, and the third dimension is color. So RGB, three dimensions. Combining RGB, you obtain all the colors. And reading this first byte, you can point directly to the pixel that we are interested. For example, I want to obtain the pixel X, Y, the red intensity, green intensity, blue intensity. I can put it directly to a byte combining this 6-7 number that I read before. This transparency, you know, just reading the first bytes, the first few bytes, you can know exactly where to point to take a single pixel. That is transparency. And also self-documentation in the header, that is an ASCII format, you can put all the information needed to use the image inside the FITS file. You can put also codicological information, you can put all the information you want in ASCII format. If you want to put something more complex in Unicode, there is a procedure that I will not illustrate now, but it's possible also to do this. So, considering all these advantages of the FITS file format, an Italian committee created this standard that is available on the UNI webpage. The standard describes a series of processes that you should follow to preserve long-term digital images in FITS format. Inside this subcommittee, I was there, I'm the editor of this standard, but there are also people from the European Space Agency, from the University of Vegada Rome, from private industries like DB-Seret, also Banca d'Italia, the Italian bank is there. A lot of people, also people from IQ and ICAR, the main archivist reality of Italy. A lot of people interested on preserving long-term data images go into this committee, and together we wrote this. And now we'll summarize briefly because I think that this is could be interesting for everyone that wants to do a digitization project and preserve long-term data images, because no one wants to lose data. Basically, what we are telling in this standard is that you have to follow the 7 requirements to obtain long-term digitization. If you do so, you will obtain an archive that will be always readable, whatever the evolution, software or hardware in the future. That's our main goal. I don't know if you tried to open a file created 20 or 30 years ago. Sometimes it could be impossible if you don't have the original hardware and software. That is quite difficult for a file created 30 years ago at this moment. We want to avoid this. So you must follow these requirements. And now we'll go quickly through these requirements to show to you why we think that these things are important. The first main requirement is homogeneity. We demand that you must use whenever possible, always the same internal structure for your file. So for example, in the header of the FITS file, always the same set of key in the same order. That's quite important. And if you produce ancillary data, for example, XML data near the FITS file, the same ancillary data with the same structure should be present for each image. Always. This is important for many reasons. I would say some reason now, but one of them, for example, is the data recovery in events of corruption or truncation. If you want to preserve the data long term, something will happen. It's inevitable. So if you know exactly how your data are structured, you can reconstruct what you lost quickly, and you can try to reconstruct what you lost more quickly. That's the idea. Validation. You should always check your data. So if you have a project digitization project in mind, you should put a list of requirements that each image satisfy. And these requirements are certainly that if you created FITS file, they should be conform to the FITS standard. And they should be conform to this uni standard, for example. But you could also have custom requirements, for example, a particular key that should always be present. Each time you create a new file, you should immediately check that the file is conform to your specification, always. This is what we call the real-time validation. And then we suggest also to perform a scheduled validation. That means, for example, at least once per year, recheck all your files in the archive and check again that all the requirements are satisfied. In this way, you can track immediately any data correction or any problems and do something to intervene. Data conversion. You have your big archive of FITS file. Probably if some collaborator, some scholar want an image of yours to work, don't want a FITS file. Probably he wants a TIFF or a JPEG, something that at this precise moment is more usable for data analysis or simply data visualization. So in this case, you don't give them FITS file, but you always create your final file from the master copy in your long-term reservation archive. In this way, you are accessing your archive and indirectly you are checking that everything is fine. An archive that is never accessed is a dead archive, and probably something will happen, you will realize it when it will be too late. So this is the why data conversion is important. To use the archive, certainly, but also to check that everything is okay. Information retrieval. Probably your archive to be used need a lot of metadata, some information that must travel with the data. What we demand here is that there should be no dependencies from external data or external database. If you need some information to use the file, this information should be contained in the file itself, for example, in the header, or in ancillary file that is present in the same long-term data visualization archive. No dependencies is one of the key of a good long-term data visualization project. And finally, three fundamental questions. There are three fundamental questions, and the answer to this question should be in the archive. First one, semantic content. What am I looking at? What is contained in this archive? The answer to this question should be in the archive itself, not outside. Origin history. What is the origin and the history of the file that I'm looking now? How it has been created? What happens in history? It has been changed because something happened. There is a new version of the file. What happens? All this history of the file should be tracked in the file itself again. Everything should be self-documented. And finally, structural models. If the data are to be used, connected with other data, because they have a meaning only if connected, for example, the pages of the book, then this connection should be contained in archive itself again. It should be easily reconstructable. It should not depend from a database or from other files that are outside your long-term reservation archive. Everything should be contained. To encourage people on using the FITS file format and use these requirements, we created this GitHub repository. I invite you to go there. You will find now a simple Java converter from TIFF to FITS, a simple Python converter from TIFF to FITS, and also the converter from raw DNG images to FITS that I showed you before. And other information are available here. on our website, yeah, we will find a description of our long-term visitation project and many other info, but please you can write me an email if you have any doubt. Okay, now I will move on to the next final topic of the talk. If you have any question, please keep it ask me at the end. I will try to go quickly on this. Digital codicology. Now we have an archive of 7 million images, half a petabyte, 500 terabytes. That counts for about 180,000 billion pixels. So indeed, this is a big data analysis. What are we doing with this data? Are we doing some kind of science? The answer is yes. Actually, we're doing a lot of things, but now we concentrate just on quantum codicology, because I think that it could be of some interest to you. What is quantum codicology? You probably already know that, but allow me to summarize quickly. Quantum codicology is a science that pick a page of a book or of a manuscript and obtain a series of parameters, transforming a page in a series of numbers. Of course, this science is quite fascinating to me because I'm not an expert of codicology, paleography, and books, but I consider myself an expert on numbers. So I do not understand quite well ancient Greek, ancient Arab, and so on, but I understand numbers. That's my job. So you can see why this is so fascinating to me. There are many parameters important, but what we identify as a priority are this one, the page size, of course, the filling coefficient, that is the ratio between the written area and the page. The written area is the smallest rectangle that contains text. The percentage of ink, so the ratio between the number of pixels that contain ink and the number of pixels that contain only parchment or paper. The exploitation coefficient, that is the density of character in the text, the number of text columns, and number of text lines. At the moment, we have code running that extract these three parameters, page size, filling coefficient, and percentage of ink. We are also working on the other parameters. And now we show to you some preliminary results of a work that we are doing inside the Valinga Library alone or in collaboration with the University Tor Vergata of Rome, in particular the Department of Physics. So first analysis, percentage of ink. The idea is to flag each pixel, basically, to decide for each pixel if it's a sink or parchment. There are several ways to do this. The most classical way is the binarization procedure. But this is not what we try to do. We try to do something different, something actually that is quite similar to something that is done in astronomy for years. The idea is to use an intensity histogram. If you pick the intensity histogram is an histogram that tells you for each intensity value possible on the image, how many pixels has that value. For example, this is the red histogram, red channel histogram. So this plot, for example, is telling to you that for the image on the left, the intensity 200 is shared by about 40,000 pixels. That's the idea. It's interesting to use this intensity histogram because you can see that you can separate quite well, at least in part, the parchment from the ink. You can see that a blank page has only this large peak that you see on the images on the left. A page with a written area has the same peak, more or less, and also another peak at lower values. That's the ink. An illuminated page has something more complex. The point is here is to discriminate in this histogram how many pixels contains ink and how many pixels contains parchment. We want only to know how many they are, not what pixel they are. And to do so, we interpolated the ink with an analytical function, in particular it is a double Gaussian, but that's not important. With this interpolation, you can statistically say how many pixels contain ink and how many pixels contain parchment for each intensity interval. That's the idea. So in this way, you obtain a number. And this analysis has been performed for 3.7 million images, 10,000 volumes. But then to move on with the study, we apply three filters. We demand that the manuscript have an origin date available, that the manuscript at least 50 pages to have some statistic we showed to you. And then we pick only manuscripts that come from Latin, Greek, or Hebrew collection. In this way, we have at the end 1.7 million images for 4,600 chef marks. This is a distribution of Latin, Greek, Hebrew. And then what do we do? For each page now, we have a number, the percentage of ink that go from 0 to 1. 0 means no ink. 1 means that the entire page is filled with ink, okay? So for each manuscript, we have a plot like this that tell you how many pages have some percentage of ink. You can see that how easy it is to discriminate in plot like this, what page contain only text, what page contain illumination, what page are evenly illuminated. And for each volume, we pick the mode of distribution. That means it's the most frequent percentage of ink that typically is associated with a typical page containing all ink, like in this example. So we came out with one number for each volume that represent the characteristic percentage of ink of that volume. Then we do plot like this one. In this plot, each black dot is a volume, a book. And the two bars represent the dispersion. The horizontal bar is the uncertainty of the origin date of the book. Typically, the uncertainty is Alpha Centauri, but sometimes it's smaller. Sometimes some manuscripts are dated, so you know exactly the date. And in vertical, the intrinsic dispersion of ink inside the manuscript, because if a manuscript contains a lot of illumination, of course, there will be a lot of percentage of ink in the book. So we obtain the general distribution for each century of the manuscript, and we obtain a plot like this one. This plot is telling us that there was a characteristic percentage of ink for centuries, then an increment that starts in the 12th century, a peak in the 14th century, and then a drop. Actually, what this is we are seeing here is an evolution of the way of writing. We are going to, from Caroline manuscript to Gothic to neo-humanistic book. And this is exactly what you are seeing here. For that concern, the Greek word, there is not much to say. It's quite an homogeneous word. More or less, there is always the same average ink percentage of ink. But there is a peak around the Fourth Crusade. It's not statistically significant, I'm afraid, but probably it will require a bit more study. For Hebrew collection, you cannot say much. There is too much dispersion. There is an hint of decrease, but it's just an hint. Honestly, you cannot say too much. We compare this result with the evolution of the exploitation coefficient. It was a study available more similar to this one. The exploitation coefficient analyzed the evolution of the density of character in the text. So it could be directly connected with the percentage of ink, but it could be also be not, because you can have character with less or more ink according to the style. In any case, what we see comparing our study with the work of Bozzolo of 84, that our trend in red and the trend from Bozzolo in green and blue for text with one or two columns are quite compatible. In particular, there is the peak on the same century. So this was a behavior already known, but it's nice to see that an automatic study do 1 million pages confirm what we know. Then we move to the analysis of the Philly coefficient evolution. The Philly coefficient is the most little rectangle that contains the text. It's the area of this rectangle and the area of the page. We obtain the Philly coefficient in two independent approaches. The first one is to projection. Basically, we pick each page and we project the image on one axis, obtaining this one-dimensional diagram here. Then we make the average of this diagram for the entire book, obtaining a diagram like the one on the left, the bottom left, the bottom right, you can see that you can obtain this really clean one-dimensional plot. It is quite easy on this plot to identify automatically the edge of the pages and the edge of the written area, and then obtain horizontal and vertical your filling coefficient. A second independent approach, and then we put everything together, of course, use morphological operators. Basically, you pick your image, you apply, you go to grayscale, you apply what you call the binarization, threshold and binarization, then it's a dilation, you spread the ink in a way, and then you mark the rectangle of the ink quite easily. Comparing with this approach together, we obtain a robust filling coefficient because we have two independent measurements, and we then pick just the measurements that are in common to avoid any errors in the two algorithms. And then we obtain an evolution of the filling coefficient over the centuries that we compare with the study of Maniaci of 95 that make a similar analysis on Latin books. This is just Latin, sorry, I didn't say that. This has been made for just the ink analysis was made for collection Latin, Greek, and Hebrew. This analysis for now just Latin, the VAT Latin collection. So comparing with Maniaci, we see that the trends are compatible, but typically our value are higher than the one of Maniaci. And also there is a clear discrepancy on the 11th century. We don't know why, we should check. Perhaps simply the two samples are different for the century. We should check exactly what's contained in the samples. And of course, we should also check for errors. Then we compare the evolution of the sides of the page with Bozzo-Lornado. There is the beautiful study of the 80. And you can see that the two trends are quite compatible. But again, there is a discrepancy. This time, the 14th century, it's well inside the dispersion, so it's not significant, but it deserves an investigation. And finally, the L over H ratio. And again, with Bozzolo, the two trends again are compatible, but they are typically lower. I don't know why, again, we should check the samples. Part of the study that I showed to you, it was actually a degree thesis in physics by Massimiliano Foffi. This is the cover of the thesis. So this is the collaboration we're doing with Vergata in this analysis, because actually many of these algorithms of image analysis that I described to you are quite often used in physics and astronomy. So concluding this part, we make an ink and percentage analysis for 10,000 chef marks, 3.7 million pages, a filling coefficient analysis in two ways from 1 million and half a million pages. What we plan to do in the next future? We want to increase the size of this corpus. We want to extract also the exploitation coefficient, a comparison in particular between the exploitation coefficient and the ink percentage would be extremely interesting, because this way you can pick the changing on style, of course, because you can pick when a character started to contain more or less ink. Then number of text column, number of text lines. And at the end, we plan to release all the data set to the public for anyone interested in using it. And finally, it's nice to try to put everything together. This is just our study. The evolution of the percentage of ink, the size of the page, percentage ink in red, size of the page in blue, and filling coefficient in green. What is telling you this plot? Many things and nothing actually at the same time. Why I'm saying that? Because, for example, let's look just at ink. Looking just at ink, you can think that in the 12th century, something happened and people started to put more text in a single page. Perhaps to save parchment, you can think, or because there is a lot more demand of book and you want to produce more books with less parchment, that could be a simple idea. But actually, the evolution of the filling coefficient is telling you that the answer is not so simple, because the ink increase, but the filling coefficient decrease. That means that you have higher margin. So my point is, this analysis is quite important in my opinion. It's a lot of fun for me to do this job, so I'm quite happy to do that. But you should be really careful on interpreting these parameters alone. You have to put all together, and with this, in this context, I can move on with my final conclusion. And I want to your opinion also on this. A digital manuscript is a box full of treasure. You can do many, many important science on a digital manuscript. It's very, very useful. You can apply big data analysis algorithm, AI, machine learning, deep learning. All these things can help. And to do so, of course, you need the people expert on this stuff. You have to translate all this advanced informatics technology to what is more meaningful in this field. For example, quantum decodology, but also OCR, pattern recognition, multidimensional analysis. So what's the key, in my opinion? The key in reality is that you need a mix of highly qualified skill. You don't need just an expert in IT, in AI, and big data that pushing a button will solve anything. We need also expert on polygraphic ecology. And you need at the same time expert in polygraphic ecology that can understand at least a bit the concept of IT, AI, big data. And also the contrary, if you have an expert that is collaborating with you, he should understand at least a little why it's important this job and why you're doing that. And you also need the expert on format, because picking the right format for data analysis, it's important as picking the right format also for data preservation. The right format can help you a lot on the analysis, on data exchange, on data dissemination. So what I would really like to see is a mix of all these skills to produce something new, beautiful, and quite useful. That's my opinion. There will be never one people expert in everything, of course. You need to mix competencies. Okay, and that's the end of my talk. Special thanks, of course, to my colleagues of the coordination of these services, Paola Manoni and Daniele Lisci. Special thanks to IT Center, Miceli, Izzo, Moroni, Ottaviani, Pagano, and of course, people in the manuscript department. There are too many to name all of them, Claudia Montuschi, Maria Gabriella Gridelli. A lot of people are collaborating, giving also simple suggestions are useful in this field. So I'm really grateful to all of them. And of course, thank you for you for listening. As promised, this is my mail address. Now, please feel free to ask me anything. But if you are seeing this video not live and you have some questions, please write to me. Not be shy. I'm quite happy to share my work and to share opinions. So please ask. And that's all.
So yeah, thank you so much for this really interesting seminar. And I just want to say something like quite easy. It's more or less like picking up the words of Mr. Dufry, that is that we really have to work on this direction right now. We really have to talk about percentage graphs and all these numbers, all these strange things, because we have paleographer, as codigrapher, and everything. We just, you know, work always with the manuscript. We always are with the ductus, and we're now trying to face this reconstruction of the ductus, and we don't know how to do it. So we're trying to, you know, use some softwares and everything. So we just trying to work together, of course, with the Institute of Mathematics and Informatics, thanks to, of course, our project. But it's not easy. It's not easy. So that's why we are here. That's why we're doing this seminar, of course. And yeah, I don't want to just like waste too much time. So I want to really say thank you so much, because actually this is really important for us. I think that we will see again this video, and we try to make notes of it, and we will stay, you know, in touch just to ask a few questions to understand what is the direction that we have to take with our project. But now it's time for question. I saw that Amber has one question, I think. I don't know. No, that's fine. Okay, because I just saw like a little hand. But yeah, let's let's begin with the questions. If there's someone, of course.
If I go too quick, for example, in some part, I can repeat. I understand that sometimes I speak too quickly. I'm sorry for that. So please tell me if that is the case.
Right.
Okay, I have a question. You show us temporarily investigation. For me is interesting, in a manuscript, for example, this that percentual of ink, is it constant in the manuscript, in one manuscript, to in the pages of manuscript, the percentual of ink, is it constant or variable? And a second question, do you think that, for example, this percentual of ink depend on the scribe? Do you think that different scribes are different percentual inks in the page?
I lost the last part. For now, for a moment, you froze. The last part of the question was, sorry, can you repeat?
Do you think that different scribes have different percentual inks in the page, for example?
Well, you mean that the percentage of ink change inside a single page?
No, I ask, there is different percentual for different scribes.
Absolutely, yes. Well, for example, if you move from a Caroline to a Gothic style, you have a quite different percentage of ink because the Gothic style, it's a lot thicker. So it contains more ink, but also different scribe, different writer use more or less ink in their drawings of the characters. So the percentage of ink alone is not enough to discriminate the writer. But if you combine all these parameters, actually, all the parameters that I listed at the beginning here, I think that it will be really, really a lot of fun, really useful to play with all these parameters available, because you can try to look at n-dimensional clustering, this clustering on n dimension. And here, I think that you can really discriminate between writer. There is a pioneer work on this from Maniaci, and I don't remember the name of the collaborator, an engineer, I suppose, that they were showing how looking at the variation of the percentage of ink and the filling coefficient, you can, on a single book, discriminate between the different codicological unit inside the book. So you can disassemble a book in its new codicological unit. And so different writer, but in that case also different mise en page. And with this parameter, you can do the job quite efficiently, I think. We will see when we will have available. Just the percentage of ink is not enough. Actually, even these three parameters alone are not enough yet. But I think that with the other three, you can really start to do something that should help on reconstructing recipes on writing, so different mise en page in different times and place. So also different writer, of course. And for that concern, the first part of your question, inside a single book, the percentage of ink can vary a lot. look, for example, this is the Urbinate Latino 1, Urblat 1. It's a Bible. It's a beautiful Urbinate Bible. Perhaps one of the most famous illuminated Bible of the world, I think. Certainly, it's beautiful. It's astonishing. Here, you have a lot of illuminated pages. And you can see that the percentage of ink can vary a lot. But actually, the most common ink is the ink that contains the text in this way. You can see this example on the left, two columns of text. So in this case, the percentage of ink actually vary a lot. But it makes sense to say that the characteristic ink of this book is the one here in black. So about 0.9, I think. That means 0.09, sorry. That means that 9% of the page is covered with ink, typically. But of course, for example, in the pages on the right, you have 72% of the page covered in ink because it's an heavily illuminated page. So it can vary a lot, yes. But it's quite useful, this method, also to discriminate between illuminated pages and not illuminated pages. You can, if you, for example, want to extract features from manuscript, for example, I don't know, you want to look for horses contained on manuscript illumination, you can, first of all, filter the pages and pick just the pages with more ink than the mode, because in this way you are certainly picking images with miniatures, with illuminations. And so now you can analyze just that subset that is smaller. So this is useful also for doing this preliminary analysis.
Thank you.
Oh, you're welcome.
There's a question on the chat right now. Okay. So,
Do you know if I read the question? I have a question. Right, do you know if this feed system is used by other libraries or the manuscript in Italy and worldwide? Is the writing a library fees to have put in place? For that concerned library, I think that at the moment we are the only one. But several libraries contacted us to understand better why we pick this format. So I really hope, but also really think that other institutions will adopt it. The FISFA format, anyway, it's used for archival, to archive documents also by the European Space Agency. They use the FISFA format not just for astronomical images, that is the best use of the format, but also to store documentation at the moment. So it's quite similar to what they are doing. Does FITS support any lossless compression? Yes, it supports compression, both lossless and lossy, but actually in our uni standard, we do not recommend it. I understand that, of course, lossless compression is quite useful to save space because storage space is expensive. But we recommend that you do not compress your data, because if you do so, you should also preserve the compression algorithm. Because if you lost the compression, if you lost the software you used to compress the image, and you lost your compression algorithm because it's not stored in your archive, you cannot read the image in the future. You should have the capability to reconstruct the compression algorithm. It could be quite complex. It could also be impossible in some cases. Moreover, an image compression means that each byte contains more than one pixel, contains a lot of pixels actually in a compressed image. That means that in event of data corruption or truncation, you losing one byte means losing a lot of pixels. In our case, no uncompressed images, in the writing library, we have all images uncompressed. One pixel, one byte is one pixel. You lose one byte for data corruption, you lose just one pixel. And you can try to recover it, for example, interpolating if it's just one pixel. So yes, there is support for data compression. We do not recommend it, but it's available, yes. Oh, you're welcome, of course. And actually, in the Valley Library, we are writing a book. It should be published next year, I think. Probably in the first semester of next year, that will describe all our digitization workflow. So there we will find, you find everything from the technique used to acquire images, so scanner, camera, and so on, to the operation that the conservation workshop do before and after the acquisition to the original object, to all the management of this workflow, and also, of course, details on the fits and the uni standard that is scheduled to do today. So if you're interested, please look at our website. Probably next year, this book will be available with all this information and so much more also.
So I just write down one question that was done on Facebook from the Lambda Research Library. And it was like,
from USA.
I'm sorry.
We have a question from USA.
Right. And okay, just write down here on the chat. And he's like, were any Bombastin manuscripts included in your analysis?
I'm sorry, I don't know what is a Bombastin manuscript. I'm really, really sorry. Can you help me on this?
It is Bombastina, it is paper.
Sorry?
It is paper made of cotton. Bombastina, this is what I suggest our colleague means.
Okay, I don't think so. I'm not certain because working on digital images, but I don't think so. Probably the almost all the manuscript analyzed so far are in parchment. I'm not certain, but I think no.
If there will be any reply, I will just tell you, because now I'm connected on Facebook too. So we will see what's going on.
Okay.
So yeah. Right. Okay. If there are any other questions, just please do them like now. We are almost over right now. And if there's not, again, I hope that you just write down the email of our, they replied to your answer, right? And it wrote, I was asking because the rate absorption of ink in Bombastin, so it's in paper, varies greatly on a page, but thank you.
Okay, I understand. Well, short answer, I don't know, honestly. But anyway, if the ink is completely absorbed, I cannot recognize it. But with this kind of analysis, you can discriminate between the number of pixels contain light ink, this ink absorbed, it almost disappeared, and dark parchment pixel in which the parchment is more dark, but it's just parchment, not ink. Because this is a statistical analysis. I understand that from all the book what is the typical behavior of this parchment, or the parchment of this page of this book, and then I can predict how many pixels should contain only parchment. That's the idea.
Okay, but I think if you have the data of 3,000 manuscripts, in that number there is a paper manuscript, not only parchment.
Sorry, this number.
Volevo dire che secondo me, se avete fatto l'analisi su così tante foto di tanti manoscritti, è molto probabile, e fino al 1800 è molto probabile che ce ne siano di carta.
No, la maggior parte. Yes. In this region, I was thinking about the Philly coefficient, because this analysis has been only on typically quite old books.
Okay.
So we go to 15th century, so probably there is something paper also in there. But yeah, you are correct. Obviously, here is most of them are paper. Yeah, absolutely. Yes.
I have another question. In most cases, we have a lost not good image we have, or we can see in internet. Do you think that it's possible to do this analysis only with very qualitatively image, or we can or it is possible to do to make analysis with not quality photograph image?
Well, it's certainly possible to use also low quality images, so images on low resolution and so on. But certainly you will, in plot like this one, you will add the noise, basically, because you will add the uncertainties that is due to the low quality of image used. So it's better to use the best available image, of course. But yes, it can absolutely be done also with low resolution images. It's better to use high resolution. You can also use compressed images, actually, in some cases. For example, this kind of analysis, the Filling coefficient analysis, you can do this in FITS format, but also in JPEG, and you will obtain the same results. But this kind of images, they ink, if you do on JPEG images that are is a compressed, loosely compressed format, then you can obtain something something different. Just a little variations, but if you sum a lot of little variation, you are adding noise on a situation that is already quite noisy because you have a lot of uncertainty in age and a lot of dispersion in ink. So this analysis of the ink, I will make it with high resolution image if I have them available, of course. This kind of analysis you can make also with JPEG and the low resolution. It will not worsen your result so much, I think. So it depends. That's the answer. Depends on the kind of analysis you're doing.
So Marco, it's always quite good to make new photos of this manuscript because we are dealing with really low quality of images that we have from, you know, different libraries and everything. And yeah, we just, you know, we are thinking
we
about.
We can try.
We can try.
But what was quite useful in this kind of analysis is that the Vatican, our archive is quite homogeneous. We have images with the same DPI, with the same typical resolution, the same quality. So you can obtain, you can have an algorithm that can really work on a lot of images. If you have something dishomogeneous, you probably have to adapt your algorithm for certain images and others, because the same one probably will not work in each image. That's one of the advantages of having something homogeneous, of course. And you have that trying to make always the same quality of images each time. In this, our photographic department is making an excellent work.
Now, actually, this was one of the questions that I wanted to do, that is about the like homogeneity of the image, the quality of the image that you must have in order to do this kind of analysis. And actually, right now, I cannot say that we have it. So so it would be a little bit different, and I think that difficult somehow. And I think that it would be better in our case, you know, for what we're doing, like to make new photos somehow when it's possible, of course, and trying to work always with the same quality and do, you know, the analysis always on the same quality image, not to have, you know, problems with the results most of the time, you know, because it could be different with a higher quality image and the low quality images. You know, you can apply the system, but the results will be different. So yeah, anyway, thank you.
I can give you also another example. For example, Vatican Lab decided to make a 24-bit color image. That means 8-bit for each color channel. So for each color channel, for example, red, each pixel can have a value going from 0 to 255. this is the possible gradation of red, green, and blue. But you can also have 12 or 16-bit images for each color. This is not useful in most cases, so this is why we pick 8. Because of course, if you go to 16 rich color channel, it will double the size of your images. So we need a lot more storage space. But for example, if you're doing an analysis like this one, now we'll change slides, I'll show you something else. It is not directly related, but I think it's interesting for you. You can see this. Okay, this is an analysis of a palimpsest. You can see here that this is a Syriac text. But if you go really carefully, you can see that this is a palimpsest. There is something on the script inferior. If you pick 12 or 16-bit multi-frequency images, so you eliminate this manuscript with lamp from the near infrared to ultraviolet, also in the part that cannot be seen by naked eye. So infrared, the ultraviolet eye that cannot be seen by naked eye. And you mix all together doing what is called a principal component analysis. It's an advanced analysis that is made in several fields, also in astronomy and physics, vastly used. You can obtain at the end something like this one, like this. You can see now the Greek text came out quite clearly. You can now read it. You can analyze it. Actually, if you're curious, this is a diagram of the end tables of Ptolemy. And to do this, it is much better to have 16-bit images, not just 8-bit. So producing 16-bit images per color channel do not make sense in many cases. But in some cases, yes, it makes sense. So again, you can perform each algorithm in each image of whatever the quality, but in some cases you need a specific quality to do a specific job.
Mm-hmm. Right. Perfect. This is a really amazing job. Like we never saw it's really uncommon to see this kind of work, you know, to double C and like this kind of analysis applied to like this
part. We are doing this. The work also the photography department. We have an impressive hardware now, a phase one camera that can do this beautiful picture, and you can take that like this one. But there are a lot of works around beautiful like this one. The most beautiful example, for example, is the palimpsest of Archimedes. Analyzed by ML, but there are a lot of examples now from palimpsest. People are recovering the impossible. You can really do a lot of things. Yes, yes.
Right.
For example, a colleague of mine, Andras Nemeth, is studying a palimpsest of Polybius that will be. I don't know if you already published it. Perhaps yes. It's a new text from Polybius. That was completely lost and now has been recovered from palimpsest. So, and this is can be made with the help of this kind of analysis. So that it's absolutely impressive.
Perfect. So, are there any other questions? If not, I think that we can just stop this. Let's see. Maybe on the chat. No. Let's try. On Facebook, because we don't know. We have a comment again from the Hilander Research Library that posted a link of Vaclav 9. It's like the manuscript. I don't know if you can. Maybe I can just put this comment on the chat. And he's saying that in this Vatican Slav 9. Is on bombacin, so in this specific material. And if you want to see how the ink varies, you can like check now.
Oh, okay.
I mean, there's the link. You can try to copy and paste it. But let's.
L'ho già copiato io.
Ah, perfect. Thank you. Grazie. Right.
I don't think this has been digitized yet. Is that available on the GVATLib? Do you check? We can check now.
Yeah, but there is a Slavonic manuscript.
Okay, yes, yes, it has been already digitized, so it's indeed available. Okay, at the moment, this manuscript was not in my list, so I did not analyze it. But I can certainly do the same analysis of this manuscript just to be curious and see how much the ink varies on inside this manuscript. Yes, it can be done, surely. Okay, I cannot do that live, of course, but I will do that. Thank you.
We are hoping you to do this now. We wanted to see how it works, but you say no.
Actually, it's not so
difficult. I'm kidding.
I've already the code in place, but I must recover the original TIFF files, so it requires a bit of preparation. That's all. But it's not a difficult analysis. When you have the code, it's a bit more than pushing a button, just a bit.
Okay, perfect.
This is the beauty of this kind of science. All your effort go at the beginning when you define the right algorithm for your science. And on this, you need both experts on the image analysis, but also expert on the object you are studying, so expert on codicology, paleography. Combining these two competencies, you came out with the right algorithm. Then it's just pushing a button with a few hours or few days, and you have your results. That's the beauty of this approach.
Perfect. I was waiting for maybe another reply, but I think that, I don't know. So yeah, maybe we can just somehow finish this. And so we thank you again for all of this. And oh yeah, thank you again for the slide in which there's your email. And
yes, when
we will post this on the YouTube, I think that I will just write down your email too, so that people will just send you some emails and just trying to ask how this stuff works. And thank you so much again. Marco, if you want to say something like...
Yes, I hope that our collaboration will continue. Because I think that is very important collaboration. There is a stupid to make anything that other made.
How to reinvent the wheel, in a simple phrase.
We continue our collaboration with the Vatican Bibliotheca library because the seminar of November will be trained by a director of the Department for Digitalization of the Manuscript of the Vatican Bibliothek on the 10th November. We have other...
Dr. Manoni. Dr. Paolo Manoni is basically my boss, yes.
Perfect. Yeah, we will have this seminar.
Gaskini ještě protazáváme sotrudničestvo s Vatikánskou bibliotekou. Zašto to sledovací seminář to bude na 10. novembri s doktor Paolo Manoni, koja to je direktor na Centar za digitalizaciju na Vatikánskou biblioteka, šefka na Giuliano Giuslida. Много сме благодарни за днешния семинар, който за мене беше много интересно, любопитно и отвори няколко посоки за нашата работа. И се надявам сътрудничество с Ватиканската библиотека да продължава не само за семинари, а за споделение на знания. Благодаря на всички, които са участвали и значи до 10 ноември.
Grazie a tutti. Grazie,
grazie.
Okay, thank you again. I hope you enjoy this. Bye bye.
Thank you. Thank you.